How many of you here, at some point in your life, were religious believers? Of course, most of us are. Why did my mind, why did your mind, why did our minds generate religious ideas, religious beliefs, and accept them? Why? And what I hope to show you this morning is the answer to those questions. We're getting tantalizingly close to a comprehensive cognitive neuroscience of religious belief, robust theories, empirical evidence. And my plan this morning is to lay out for you some of the basics for this, and then to give you some of the empirical evidence, and to end on a historical note that I think both illuminates the past and the present and may tell us something about the future. The way to think about my talk is that I hope to give you, in a sense, like a Swiss Army knife. A Swiss Army knife of tools that you can take back to your community in the debates that you have with believers. Where do we start? We start with Darwin. Darwin's remarkable idea not only gives us the only workable explanation we have for the design and variety of all life on Earth, his idea gives us the only workable explanation we have for the design and architecture of the human mind. And in that architecture, the pieces that generate religious belief. Basically, you take Darwin's idea, combine it with Watson and Crick, with genetics, and you have this. This is the modern Darwinian synthesis. Every organism is an integrated collection of problem-solving devices designed over evolutionary time by natural selection to promote in some specific way the genes that produce that adaption. Let's look at us. Look at me, okay? The heart solves the problem of pumping blood. Hemoglobin solves the problem of transporting oxygen. The lung solves the problem of extracting oxygen from the air. At every single level of biological inquiry, from membranes to mind, Darwinian natural selection. Now, this statement also, I want you to look at carefully, is also a statement about the human mind. The mind is what the brain does, and the brain evolved under the same rules of natural selection. The brain is a collection, an integrated collection of problem-solving devices designed over evolutionary time by natural selection to promote in some specific way the genes that built that adaption. Steven Pinker has the analogy that the human mind is like the Apollo spacecraft, this compact collection of engineering devices solving a constant stream of problems, only a few of them conscious to the astronauts. Now, the other fundamental is this, that we are, and we now know, risen apes, not fallen angels. We arose in Africa, put aside our ethnic, religious, racial differences. Underneath our skins, we are all Africans. We are all, every one of the 6 billion people on this planet, we are all sons and daughters of a small band of hunter-gatherers that arose in Africa about 70,000 years ago and conquered the world. We're the last surviving hominid. You may not know it. This is your family history. Over here, the common ancestor with chimps and bonobos. And then this is the hominid line. Australopithecines, Lucy, Panthropus, and then here we are, Homo, our genus Homo. Homo habilis, Homo erectus, Homo heidelbergensis, Homo neanderthalis, and then we're the last surviving hominid. This is Lucy up here, Homo erectus, about 2 million years ago, and us. And notice in particularly the area of the frontal lobes. This shows it a little bit clearer. On the left is the skull of a Homo erectus. On the right, Homo sapiens. Notice in particular the enlargement of the frontal lobe area. For evolution, pretty quick period of time, we evolved these frontal lobes. Why? If you remember, 1.5, 2 million years ago, Homo erectus left Africa without language, went to Indonesia, the Caucasus, really, in some sense, conquered half the world. They had conquered the physical environment by a million years ago. So what was left? What was the most challenging, complex part of our environment that drove the evolution of us? Well, the most challenging, complex part of the environment was probably each other. And this is the origin of our complex social cognitions. Why is this important? Because religious ideas, religious beliefs, are just the extraordinary use of everyday cognitions, everyday adaptations, social cognitions, agency detection, precautionary reasoning. That religious beliefs are a byproduct of cognitive mechanisms designed originally for other purposes. Now, what's a byproduct? I noticed a few people taking notes. Reading and writing is a cultural byproduct. We don't have reading and writing modules in our brain. It's a byproduct of fine motor skills, vision, language. Music is a byproduct of language, hard vowels and consonants put to rhythm, originally the rhythm of a beating heart. And this is the essence of what religions are. Religions are byproducts of cognitive mechanisms, everyday cognitive mechanisms, that created and arise really as an artifact of our ability to imagine social worlds. They're always, every religious idea is a human concept with some slight alteration. Now, how many of you here love Big Mac meals? Now, come on, I'm a psychiatrist. You can tell me, you know, it's confidential information, it's protected by HIPAA rules. You can tell me, how many of you love Big Macs? Come on. Of course. How many of you have cravings for broccoli? Cravings for broccoli. I mean, you can see there's variation in a species, but there's very few. All right, why? The reason for this is that if you understand the psychology of the Big Mac meal, you understand the psychology of religion. I'm serious. I mean, let me show you this, okay? We evolved adaptations for things that were crucial and rare. Sugars of ripe fruit, fat of lean game meat, of salt. Those were crucial adaptations in our past. And the modern world creates a novel form of it that comes from those adaptations, but hijacks them with supernormal stimuli. Okay, not ripe fruit, but a Coca-Cola. Not lean game meat, but you know, a fat hamburger. French fries soaked in meat juice. And it creates these supernormal stimuli, but they're based on ancient adaptations.